All right, Ken Jeong, how are you?
Fine. How are you guys doing?
Doing great. Just fine. I'm Deuce. This is my co-host, Brandi.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you doing this morning? First of all, congratulations, man. We're going to get into it in more depth, but your career has been just unprecedented, I think.
Yeah, man. It's just been beyond blessed. I mean, I really, as the season's winding down, we're promoting the last three episodes of the season. I'm really like, I can't believe any of this is happening. I mean, there's still a part of me that can't believe any of this stuff is really happening.
And we're talking about Dr. Kennedy's on 8:30 on Friday nights on ABC. And, you know, I'm sure you've talked about it a billion times to the extent that your show is based around it. But if anyone doesn't know, you started out very, very far away from Hollywood.
Yes, I was a real doctor. It's based on my real life. Being a doctor at an HMO for 7 years is like it, and the more I say it, the more I realize how unbelievable it is. Because you're like, yes, Mr. Chow used to be a doctor. That's basically what we're saying.
Exactly.
And it's true. And it's kind of shown how much full circle this is, but also how much, even in the last 7 years since The Hangover, how I've evolved as a person, as a parent. My kids were 1 year old when we filmed The Hangover, and now they're almost 9 years old, going next month.
It's crazy.
So it's very fitting that Dr. Ken is a family sitcom as my kids are growing up. And tonight's episode deals with the talk. It's called Dave's Sex Talk. And Ken holds off on giving Dave the talk of the B's and B's so much that the babysitter ends up giving him the talk.
Oh, no.
And, yeah. And then the babysitter, who is our chief resident at the HMO, she gets all her facts wrong because she's not that experienced. So,
now,
so the school reports Dave for talking about sex, not about the actual sex, about the fact that he's saying many wrong things about sex.
Yikes.
Now, I have to ask, I mean, you're not just the star of it, but you're the creator. You do producing, you write the show. I mean, you're kind of involved in every aspect of Dr. Ken. What is that like? Do you have crazy long days? What's it like to just kind of be so involved?
It's a 24/7 job. It just never goes away. Even when you're home, you're always thinking of it. I mean, it's the most involved I've ever been on any project, you know, because I'm wearing so many different hats. It's one thing also to be the lead actor. That's tough enough where you're involved in, you know, majority of the scenes. But then when you're also one of the writers, one of the producers, one of the editors, and then also, you know, I'm here in New York promoting the show. It definitely is, like, all-encompassing. And but it's been the most fulfilling year of my career because of the many hats I've been wearing.
Now, when it comes to the writing, I mean, are you in kind of are you actually in the writer's room? Are you kind of getting into it, like, really completely engaged in the process, kicking ideas around? Or are you kind of in a role where it's like, hey, we've got these ideas, which way do you want to go with it? Where kind of people come to you with things and you kind of have final approval on it?
Oh, you know, I was in pre-production 10 weeks before we even shot it, and I was there every day, our first episode, and I was there every day with the writer's room, keeping their hours and pitching ideas just like any other writer would. And I really was able to keep that up. There are times when I'm promoting and busy filming where if I'm traveling, you know, they will present some ideas. And I remember promoting Ride Along 2 in January where I was in Miami for a week and the writer's room was still going on. So every time I got back to my hotel room, I'd be in the middle of a rewrite session. It was basically like a Skype chat with the writers.
Okay.
I really love being involved with the writer. And then, but while I film, after rehearsal every day, I go to the writer's room. And it's not just supervising. I get in there and I pitch jokes I pitch scenarios just like any other writer would.
That's so very cool.
And that's been the most fun. That's been the most fun because, I have to go about my own character. Really just, and one of the biggest compliments I've ever been told ever on my show is just like, you bring a nice energy to the writer's room and you're not selfish. You're not, hey guys, give me some more lines. I'll give you some cookies or something like that.
Right.
You know, it's not about me. It's about the ensemble. And I'm more passionate about the other characters really than I am about my own character. I'm really, because I know that you need to have a good ensemble to have a good show.
And that's got to be awesome too, because I have friends that have worked in TV as a writer or do work in TV as a writer. And it just seems like there's just this, it's almost like a living, breathing thing. There's this community involved, and everybody's bouncing ideas off of each other. So it's cool that you get an opportunity not only to kind of get the, I don't want to put it this way, the glory of being the star of the show, but you also kind of get to be a part of the inner workings and feel that kind of vibe with the other writers.
Yeah, that's exactly it. I mean, I'm proud. There are a lot of jokes. There are a few jokes that I've written myself that are told by some of the other cast members on the show, you know, and no one really knows it except me. Like, oh, I came up with that bit, you know, in the writer's room. And it's really, you know, it's really cool. Like, oh, cool, one of my own personal jokes that I wrote for some other people made it in the cut.
Let's be honest.
That's the biggest thrill for me.
You just like the control of feeling like not only do you have the good lines, you provided the good lines for other people, right? You just want the power.
It's really less unselfish than me being the ultimate control freak, yeah.
That's awesome. And now, speaking of controlling things, you are far beyond just doing acting and even comedic things. You directed a 30 for 30 for ESPN, too. Is that correct?
Yeah, I did a 30 for 30 short film.
Okay.
And it wasn't a full-length film, but yeah, I did that last year. The first thing I ever directed is called Student Athlete. It's about Reggie Ho, a kicker from Notre Dame for Lou Holtz's championship team, who became a doctor. And he's a prominent cardiologist in Philadelphia. And it was ESPN came to me about directing that, because this is about a celebrity who became a doctor, and as opposed to a doctor who became a celebrity, and kind of getting in the skin of that, you got a real sense of what he went through. And that was really cool.
That's awesome. Yeah.
It was one of my proudest, you know, not many people know about it, but probably one of the proudest things of my career, because A, it's the first thing I've ever directed, and B, I'm a huge 30 for 30 fan. So to have my own little moment, you know, in a short film it was huge to me.
We just have a few more moments left. Is that somewhere you can see yourself going in the future as doing more directing work?
Oh, absolutely. I'd love to direct episodes of Dr. Ken, and I definitely would love to direct my own prom. I'm a control freak, so I got it, you know. If I got a couple of Judge Mathis jokes in on Dr. Ken, I got to direct a couple of things, you know.
All right. You could check Dr. Ken out 8:30 p.m. Fridays on ABC. But if your past is any indication, you don't have to seek Ken Jeong out too much. You will find him eventually. He pops up all the time. So continued success, and hope that everything goes well. Congratulations on the first season. Hope that you have many, many, many more, and hope that you have so many that you run out of people to write for the show, and you come back around and bring us on board.
That sounds like a plan. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
You have a great day. All right, thanks for talking to us.
Thanks, you too. Bye.